Make a great game even better with the Satellites and Commanders expansion for the Artemis Project from Grand Gamers Guild. We have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy of this expansion and also for being a sponsor of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, though that actually happened after we got this review copy.
The Artemis Project Satellites and Commanders is an expansion from designer Daniel Roki. Features artwork from Christian Romero. You'll need a copy of the Artemis Project to play this. Just in case you don't know it, though, the Artemis Project is one of the best dice-based worker placement games we played. Be sure to check out our Artemis Project review, then come back and see what we have to say about this expansion.
Satellites and Commanders keeps the same player count of 1-5, but is considered best with 4. And it does up the playtime of the Artemis Project by a bit, maybe by 10 to 15 minutes per player.
It also increases the weight by a small amount as it adds at least 5 new options on every player turn.
So Satellites and Commanders adds 2 new things to the games of the Artemis Project. Can you guess what they are? Right? First, you got satellites. They dock with off-board locations called chariots, which can influence the main board actions. Then you have commanders. These are a new type of colonist that you can promote your existing folk into at the cost of an expedition badge. These are powerful as they count as wild cards and can be used to bump the value of your dice without affecting the dice rank.
Now we have the deluxe edition of Satellites and Commanders, which came from the Kickstarter and which you can still get direct from Grand Gamers Guild. The only thing that sets this version apart from the retail are the cute little plastic satellite die holders.
And there are 3D models on BoardGameGeek for printing your own satellites. Okay. Now, get a look at these fantastic official satellites for in our Artemis Project Satellites and Commanders unboxing video on YouTube, which is also worth watching, even if you're considering the retail version, since our box includes everything in the retail box as well as these extra satellites.
You can also just buy these satellites direct from Grand Gamers Guild if you just really want the plastic ones, too. Now, at first, I thought those satellites were a bit over the top and ridiculous, but you know what? I don't know. There's something about this game with its chonky, like, first player marker. It's just kind of an aesthetic to it. But once I picked one up and put a dice in the satellite, I was like, no, I'm sold. That just feels good. The other component quality is also great. The new chariot tiles are kind of nice. They go in the corners of the board, give me a bit of a talisman flashback. There's new buildings, expedition and event cards, custom dice. Similar to the base game, iconography on these new components is excellent, though I do wish the text on the chariot tiles was bigger.
It's not that bad, though, because there's only 4 of them. You pick them up, you read them all at the beginning of the game, and then you pass them around and set them down the corner, so that one doesn't bother me too much. And I know when we first cracked this game open, I saw those chunky satellites, and I thought they were the silliest looking thing I'd ever seen, and I thought it would make the expansion not fit in the base box. But I actually love them. They are super utilitarian because they are at a nice angle when they're sitting. You can clearly see the die number on them from across the board. I actually like the way that they're angled, the way they sit, the way they fit onto the chariots. I actually like everything about the silly components.
Yeah, even in good light, you really do kind of need to read the chariots before the game, maybe even make a note. Otherwise, you may keep asking to see them throughout. If you're a regular player, though, I expect you'll learn them and it won't be a problem soon enough. You'll just know, oh, that's the one that does that.
Adding Satellites and Commanders to the Artemis Project is pretty simple. You randomly draw chariot tiles until you have one for each corner of the board. Place the new academy tile on top of the academy spot. Mix the new buildings, events, and expedition cards in with the originals, and then set up the game as normal.
No, when playing with this expansion, you need to play on harsh mode, meaning you do not add 2 extra resources to the vents and the quarry during board setup. As for the satellites, you use 1 less than the number of players.
Now, there's an optional rule in this expansion I like, and I've seen it in a few other expansions before, but I always enjoyed this. If you really want to experience the new stuff, what they recommend is instead of just mixing in the new buildings and stuff, remove an equal amount of the existing stuff beforehand. That way you have a better chance of seeing the stuff in the expansion.
Yeah, I love that because when I get a new expansion, I'm all excited to see what it does. I like that idea. All of the standard rules from the Artemis Project apply here. During the placement phase, players now have the option to claim a satellite. They place a die onto an unclaimed satellite and then place that satellite into an open chariot. Or they can steal a satellite that's already at a chariot by playing a lower die than the one that's currently there. And if this replaces an opponent's base die, they go up on the exposure track. But if it replaces their satellite die, they don't.
When going through the resolution phase, you now start with the chariot on the top right section of the board, which influences the expedition phase. If a player has a satellite there, they get to use the effect on that chariot. If it's empty, it's skipped. You continue going around the board, resolving things as normal, but stopping at each chariot space before resolving the actions on that next side of the board.
So Satellites and Commander comes with a total of four different chariots for each of the four corners of the board, each with its own ability. Now, the value of the die in the satellite affects how powerful the ability will be. Now, the top right chariot affects expeditions, and some of the abilities we've seen is getting bonus victory points if you're first in an expedition, or letting you move a die from one expedition to another before you resolve that area.
So if that's not clear, we're talking about four different chariots in one corner, and then another four over here, not a total of four for the game. Because as Mo was reading it out, I thought you might not be getting it clear. There's actually quite a bit of variability here. The bottom right chariot will affect the vents in the quarry and includes things like getting to take resources that are left over after these spots resolve or getting to exchange resources. And the bottom left chariot affects the gantry with abilities like getting to buy buildings from the top of the deck or getting resources back if you build more than one building.
The top left chariot affects either the doorstep or the academy, with abilities like getting to train your existing colonists for free or getting free colonists. During the upkeep phase, players have to decide if they want to keep their satellites or not. This costs 2 minerals to keep and has you replace your placement die with one of the new satellite dice, which is rolled up to the next highest number. Then, all satellites orbit the board one position, moving to the next chariot clockwise around the board.
Commanders are a bit simpler. The academy spot on the board has been changed, so it now has one spot to train your colonists like the old rules, but a new spot for upgrading a colonist to a commander. You place a die there along with one of your colonists, and each colonist has a value, which is added to the value of your die. When you resolve the spot, it's only the player with the highest total that can actually promote to their colonist to a commander. Everyone else suffers one exposure.
Commanders, once acquired, are very powerful and versatile. They can occupy any spot in any building and count as the colonist shown. They also count as all colonist types for any other ability that's based on the number where you have to have a specific type.
The other thing you can do with commanders is you can include them with a die you are about to place. They increase the value of that die by 2, but do not change the relative position of the die, which is based on the pips shown. So you can place a 3 in the vents, but with a commander you will get 5, while still drafting before anyone who plays 4 or higher.
Now if that's not enough, each commander also gets their own free swap during the upkeep phase. You pick which color they are when scoring surface buildings, and then you get to pick again when counting up sets of colonists at the end of the game.
There are also rules for including this expansion when playing solo, but I'm sorry to say we didn't actually try this. You're going to have to discover that one on your own.
One thing I know that Mo mentioned during the unboxing is that he thought you could only use part of this module, like only use the satellites or only the commanders. That's not actually the case. At least it's not designed to be used that way. This is not a modular expansion. It's all or nothing, satellites and commanders.
Though I'm sure you could house rule it, like you'd have to go through the buildings and like if you don't want to use the satellites, pull out all the buildings referencing satellites and the events referencing satellites, or you could do it the other way around. Now, I don't remember if there are actual cards that reference both, but if there were, you'd have to pull those out too.
Yeah, given the relative power of each portion of the expansion, I have a hard time believing it would actually be balanced. Your mileage may vary.
So getting to our thoughts about this expansion, and I got to say, I think all three of us agree this is a welcome addition to the Artemis Project. It takes a game we like and adds both breadth and depth. There are more options and more strategic ways to play. It also reduces some of the randomness and to me just makes the game better. There's more randomness mitigation. The new buildings and events make things a little less predictable, which I think is a good thing, because at the high player count before, you'd see every building and you'd see every expedition. Now, you never quite know what you're going to get. You're getting more options, and now I find low rolls are more valuable than ever, so there's more things you can do with those low-value dice with the satellites, because stealing satellites requires lower dice. It also felt like there was more room for mistakes, that if you messed up one thing, there were more ways to recover.
There was more reasons to actually want to be first player and not hope you were actually last player, because being able to sneak in and steal a satellite can be kind of cool. There's just a lot of neat little bits being added on here, and it just felt like more like without really changing the core of the game.
Yeah, the commanders in particular, I think, was the most beneficial in balance. It almost feels like something that should have been there from the start, but if it's had on its own, I think it would have been too powerful. So it needed that balance of the satellites.
And I like those satellites myself. I think they're really neat. I like that hard decision at the end of the round, keep them or not. And this was even more interesting once we started to see buildings that rewarded you for having an active satellite and expedition rewards that were based on satellites. So sometimes there was encouragement to keep them going longer than you might have. And also encouraging your opponents to steal them for you from you before you got those benefits.
Yeah, I have to say I wasn't as excited about the commanders as I am about the satellites. The satellites really made this expansion for me, and I think if it was modular, I would be leaving the commanders out.
Yeah, the problem I saw though, that is only one chariot is super useful and the others are less beneficial. Again, and that all comes down to the combination of which ones turn up. Mm-hmm. It does become a bit of a knife fight for that one location, and the rest are mostly ignored unless you happen to have a special need, like a building that requires you to have a satellite.
And Deanna called this out. The other thing I really like is the number of different satellites, because you've got two-sided styles for each corner. So four different possibilities in each corner and 16 different powers. And I think my math on this is right. I think that's 4 factorial. Which gives you 256 different possible combinations of chariots. So it's unlikely two games ever end up with the same mix.
As I said, variability.
Yeah, I think your mileage will probably vary with some chariot combinations being better than others. And there may end up being, you know, you end up with your favorites and you're like, hey, can we play with chariot setup X today?
And now, unlike Deanna, I love the commanders. I think they're awesome. I like having them. I like the way they make you feel less constrained. You have more options. The game's a little less tight, but in a good way. Plus, they help with some of the randomness mitigation. And while I just dig the chunky meeples, I don't know, to me, they look like Judge Dredd with the big shoulder pads. And that makes me smile.
Oh, Judge Dredd. I love that. You know, I keep ignoring the commanders and you keep winning with the expansion while I keep not winning. So maybe that's a me problem.
Maybe.
Yeah, as I said, I think they suit the game very nicely, adding a sort of finishing polish while being balanced in their strength by having those satellites for everyone else as well.
Now, something else I do like from this expansion, I think is a big balance thing compared to the scoring in the original game that mainly comes from the commanders, upgrading commanders, but some of the new events and buildings do it too, is a way to spend those expedition badges. In the original game, badges always felt like something that you had two choices on. You either went all in on trying to do as many expeditions as you could, get as many as you could, and tried to get those high scoring values of like 8 or more, or you didn't bother with them. You barely touched them. You just made sure you had the bare minimum of 2 so you don't lose 3 points. I love that this expansion gives you reasons to go on expeditions and worthwhile ways to spend them.
Yeah, I think that's the biggest change here. Is that the badges become a commodity that you are spending, and that balance between not wanting to spend too many because you don't want to go negative, or maybe you do, maybe it's worth it, you know, but it's an expensive thing to earn to be able to play in game. And that was the biggest change.
Yeah, as well as the more ways to get them, which gives you those more ability to get the big badge points at the end of the game, so much more reasonable than the struggle it had been to get them. That is, if you can resist spending them.
So honestly, that if you like Artemis Project, get Satellites Commanders. It's that simple. It makes a great game better. The only downfall I can find with this expansion at all is that it makes the game longer. But I think that extra time's worth it.
Yeah, 100%. If you have the Artemis Project, just go pick this up.
Yeah, if you've played the Artemis Project and thought it was a good, solid game, but not one you're going to be seeking out playing on your own, I recommend giving it another shot with Satellites and Commanders. It may just be enough to change it from a game you like well enough to one you really enjoy.
If you don't own the Artemis Project but are intrigued by it, if we've sold you through the review of Artemis Project in this one, I would recommend picking them both up at once, right? I don't often say get the base game and the expansion at the same time, but I would. I know Mark likes to bundle them at cons. If you ever see Grand Gamers Guild booth at a con, and there's an offer right now at grandgamersguild.com where you can get an Artemis all-in bundle. Now, that does include the Artemis Project, Satellites Commanders, but also a standalone game called the Artemis Odyssey. That's a re-theme of the classic game Ad Astra, but we haven't gotten that one to the table yet. So I'm going to guess it's probably worth it, but we haven't tried that one ourselves.
And remember, when you do go shopping at Grand Gamers Guild, be sure you use our code Bellhop, B-E-L-L-H-O-P, and save 10%.
Also, if you happen to have or can easily get the retail version of Satellites and Commanders, you can just get the upgraded satellites direct from Grand Gamers Guild.
That's all we have to say about the Artemis Project, at least for now. So far, Satellites and Commanders is the only expansion, and a very solid one, that we strongly recommend fans pick up. Well, I wouldn't say this is a must-have expansion, because it doesn't fix the base game. It just makes it better.
What's an expansion you picked up for a game that just took that game you loved and made it a bit better? Not something you think everyone must have or that makes an unplayable game playable, just something that takes what a game offers and improves on it enough to make that expansion worth it. We'd love to hear all about it in the comments.
If you enjoyed our The Artemis Project coverage, including this expansion review, be sure to heart, like, or thumbs up this post wherever you found this. Even better, share a link with your game group, family, or friends. Help us get the word out about this and other great hobby board games.